Morning and welcome to the 26th meeting in 2024 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. Please note that Pam Gosell and Fulton McGregor are joining us remotely this morning, and I remind all members and witnesses to ensure their devices are on silent. And I welcome Colette Stevenson, MSP, to her first meeting and invite her to declare any relevant interests.
Good morning, convener. It's lovely to be here, and I have no declaration of interest.
Thank you very much, and thank you for substituting for Emma Roddick this morning. The second item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 3 and 4 in private. Are our members agreed? We're all agreed. Thank you. The next item on our agenda is to take evidence as part of our pre-budget scrutiny for 2025 to 26, and we're joined by Professor Heald, who's an emeritus professor at Adam Smith Business School at the University of Glasgow, Bill Howitt and Keith Yates, who are both members of the Merkit Group, and Alison Payne, who's the research director at Reform Scotland. And I welcome the witnesses to the meeting. We're going to turn to questions, and we will try to direct our questions to specific witnesses where possible. But if you would like to come in, please indicate to myself or the clerks, and there's no need for you to operate your microphones. We'll do that for you. One less thing to think about while you're being asked questions. We've got about 90 minutes for this discussion, and I'd like to start with a broader maybe framing question, which is I think we'd be interested to get, and so this would be for all of you, I'd be interested to get your views on how the forthcoming budget process and local government settlement could do more to empower local democracy and ensure communities get the services they need. A big one to start off with. So who'd like to start that?
David? In the absence of anybody else coming in, I will start myself. I think we shouldn't become too concerned just about the current budget process. The basic problems about the governance of Scotland. So there are much broader issues, and there are issues that concern both spending and tax. The most obvious thing is the decline of the role of local government within Scotland. The most blaring point, of course, is council tax. Council tax is now ridiculous. Based on 1991 values, we're in a very strange position because 25 years into devolution, the way in which the funding system for Scottish public spending has gone has been that we now have a position where income tax is considerably higher for certain groups in Scotland than it is in England. But it would appear that council tax is significantly lower. So there's almost been a switch from income taxation from property taxation, where I think most economists would argue if anything the direction should be a different one. My experience of giving evidence to committees of this Parliament is that members are pretty clear what has to be done about these issues, but nobody actually dare move. Obviously, the fact that you have a cycle of UK parliamentary elections, Scottish parliamentary elections, and council elections means that elections are always on people's time horizon. So I think that one of the things we need to think about is whereabout we want the system to be in 5 or 10 years' time, because the great danger is there's so many short-term fixes that, although it probably intend it to be short term, actually accumulate as things which become permanent.
An interesting perspective. I think I'll just point out at this moment that I believe that the government does have a council tax review group that is working on looking at it. So that's maybe a start. But okay, going by the expressions on some of your faces, maybe we won't hold our breaths on that. But yeah, Bill, come on in.
I do recall, Chair, something called the Burt Report. 2006. So I don't know why you're having a review group. Pretty much covered it as far as I'm concerned. To answer your specific, first of all, can I just endorse everything David said? We should declare interest here because he and I go back a very, very long way. So this isn't the first time we've been sat together doing things. Everything he says is absolutely right. But to answer your question specifically, and I'm sure you would like a nice brief answer, If you want the answer to your question as to how this committee can best contribute to improving local government, indeed council services, I would suggest you take paragraphs 23 to 26 of part one of our report and use that as the opening section of your evidence, because it basically says what David said. We as the Mercat Group have been looking at this for a long time. In the short term, I recognise, and I think you also will recognise, that you're in a budget process which is set, and it's limited because at the end of the day you're getting a block grant in the same way that councils get revenue support grant. So what's the best thing you can do at the moment? Well, again, I'll give you a very simple answer. The Scottish Government should honour the Verity House Agreement in the first instance.
Okay, thanks for that. Alison, do you want to come in?
Just to carry on with the consensus, completely agree with everything that's been said before. I think if you want to give local communities a stronger voice, you need to give local government a stronger voice. You need to reform local government. Discussions that have been had before, you need far better empowerment of local government, you need to reform the council tax. All these big things need to be done, and I think the problem is there's always an election coming. There needs to be far better, longer term looking in terms of how do we do these things, rather than, well, we've got an election coming up, and not wanting to risk upsetting voters. I think there's been too much of that. I think there needs to be a bit more of a working with the public and explaining in a cross-party way that decisions need to be made, that we need to make these changes, and also helping explain the importance of local government. I think if you were to look at sort of turnouts and participation in local government elections, we perhaps don't value it as much as we do, but I'm not sure there's a as good understanding as to how important and crucial it is that the local services that communities rely on are delivered by local authorities. But local authorities shouldn't just be the delivery arm of central government. I think there's a line in the programme for government about a national approach delivered locally. That's not necessarily the right way to think about it. We should be doing things differently in local areas to best meet those local communities, and that helps give local communities a voice. Doing the same thing all over the country kind of negates that voice.
Okay, thanks for that. I think that's an interesting point that you picked up, that was in the national approach delivered locally was actually in the PFJ, because I think that was something we were talking about a couple of years ago at the beginning of the Verity House Agreement, that we were going to try to move away from the delivery arm kind of approach for local government. I haven't dug into anything about the Verity House Agreement because I know colleagues have got questions on that, but I think that was a good point. I wanted to pick up on the levels of capital funding and get a sense from you what impacts you think the levels are having on the state of existing infrastructure and meeting requirements relating to housing and net zero. And we are in a time of restricted capital resource. How do you think councils should prioritise their capital spend? Bill?
Well, as we said in our submission, this is a matter that I think needs people that are actually in the field at the moment. And we're, let's be honest, we're the old dinosaurs looking at it from afar. What I can tell you, though, is from my experience, and Keith, I'm sure, will come in and support me and give some more examples on this, is that councils generally have developed over the years, particularly since Best Value was introduced, a whole series of ways of dealing with taking hard decisions. Now, in my own council, and I'm out of it now nearly 20 years, for our capital programme, we had a well-developed system of prioritising things. We went to the council, we agreed a set of principles, we agreed a scoring system, we did a blank, anonymised report where councillors scored the various capital projects that were deemed to be fit for the corporate strategy, and we then had a full council session where the scores were revealed and then it was debated. And the most surprising thing about that process, that I certainly remember my council was an independent council, it was non-political, but the most surprising thing about that process, and that was to officers and councillors, was the amount of consensus that emerged from the initial scoring round. So these processes exist within councils, and I think I would just, and to finalise my comment here, make the point that if we are indeed talking about honouring what Donald Dewar originally said about devolution and what the Verity House Agreement and the McIntosh Report and various other reports have recommended over the years, that we are actually going to empower people at local level, then it should be left to the people at local level to develop their own ways of developing or identifying what their priorities are. Keith, you've probably, I don't know what your system would have been in Stirling, but that's a broad outline of how what we did in Corran and Elinshire.
Yes, I think not just in Stirling, but going back prior to 1996, when the regional councils and district councils were operating, what you had when you're devising and settling a capital programme is most of the key players around the table, water, sewerage, roads, education, estates, finance, and so on. And post-1996, after the reorganisation, which was supposedly about bringing two different levels of authorities together, the regions and the districts, or unitary authorities, nothing wrong with that in principle. However, the irony of it was that a whole lot of local authority services disappeared into what I could call Quangoland. There's 113 of them in Scotland at the moment. And that meant when you're dealing with the capital programme, it's a lot more difficult to settle which are the priorities, because you are dependent upon outside organisations to actually deliver some of the key infrastructure that's required. And when you begin to look now at the capital programme and how year after year it's delayed, not just for housing, but across all of the services, a large part of that is what I think Bill has identified in the report is it's almost a lasagna or a sort of mini stroni of different organisations all trying to play this game. And they've all got different sets of priorities, many of them coming from a Scottish level. Understandably, you set priorities, they go down the line to a particular organisation. But it doesn't necessarily square with what's happening in the local authority. So this is one of the reasons why there's been persistent delays in capital spending, this failure to have things fully integrated in the way that perhaps they were, not fully, but to a greater extent prior to 1996. And maybe the last point is just to remind you that until 1996, local government in Scotland spent approximately 42% of all the public expenditure. It's now somewhere around 28, 29%. And the reason for that delay is partly because services have been taken out, partly because local government has got a worse settlement than major services like health, which has grown immensely during that period. And thirdly, just the fact that when you're dependent upon the system whereby austerity bites in Scotland, just as it does across the rest of the UK, that's impacted very heavily on local government. So I think the capital spending issue is more complex than just about what figures go out. It's about the networking between the different organisations that should work together to deliver.
OK, thanks very much for those perspectives. David, Alison?
I think the only thing I would add is it's not one of the questions that we looked in detail, but I'd want to echo, I think Joe Armstrong made the point last week about the sort of the challenges of dealing with existing assets whilst trying to develop new. And I think that's a really important one that goes across the looking at the sort of the preventative side of things as well, that when you're having these two pulling priorities.
I think there's a broader issue about the way in which the UK governments, when there's a fiscal squeeze, actually cut capital. There's a great temptation to cut capital spending and to protect existing services and jobs. This happened very much at the time of the global financial crisis, and it's continued since. And under the previous UK government, the future capital programmes were cut back. Now, that has an effect to Scotland through the Barnett formula, through the kind of capital deld which the Scottish Government gets. I think one of the things which I noticed when preparing for this evidence session is the extent to which local authorities are actually doing more of their own borrowing. It was a less capital grant from the Scottish Government, and local authorities are doing more borrowing. The questions asked about the financial sustainability of local authorities. And I think there you have to be very careful to distinguish between the aggregate Scottish level about whether the system as a whole looks sustainable and what the position is at individual local authorities. The SPICE briefing, which has been prepared for this meeting, actually is very informative about levels at Scotland as a whole, and also the variation in position of councils in terms, for example, of their debt per head and of the proportion of their revenue budgets are actually going to pay debt interest. So I think that the committee has to think both at the aggregate Scottish level and also at the individual council level. The other point is that the Scottish government, the Scottish Parliament, has to kind of engage with its UK counterparts, because if the UK government reacts to its fiscal inheritance by further cuts in capital, that's going to spiral down the system. You cannot plan capital sensibly on a year-to-year basis. You need a kind of framework five, ten years ahead. Another issue that's really important is about the fact that delivery of capital expenditure in the British public sector is actually very poor. There's some evidence that costs are considerably higher in the UK than in comparable European countries. And my personal view is that one of the reasons for high costs and delays and disruption in capital programmes is because the private sector gears up to bid for contracts. They get their workforce established, they get a certain flow of contracts, and then the pipeline stops and that capacity deteriorates. So when the government wants to have more capital expenditure, the whole thing, you have to go through the cycle again.
Okay, so you talked about the need for a 5-2 year kind of planning ahead and like a kind of pipeline, it sounds like. How would we get there? Is that a UK government level decision?
I mean, essentially, it's got to come from the UK level in the first place. One of the things of giving evidence to committees of the Parliament over the years is everybody agrees there should be multi-year planning. The spending review system set up in the late 1990s actually encapsulated the idea that you had multi-year spending plans. But more recently, partly for political reasons, partly because of economic circumstances, spending reviews have often been for 1 year. Sometimes there haven't really been spending reviews for forward years. So it basically has to come down originally from the UK government. The UK government's got to actually commit itself to spending reviews, and these are supposedly coming in next spring. Then the Scottish government can actually then give multi-year figures for local government and for public bodies and the third sector. So basically, everybody says we want multi-year planning, but unless the system as a whole is put in place, that will never actually happen.
Okay, and that gets triggered at a UK level. Yeah. Okay. I'd like to move on to an area around the local authority debt and get a sense from you, and maybe David, I'll start with you and then go to others if they want to come in, whether you think the rise in the local authority debt by 1 billion between 2021 and 2022 and 2022-23 gives rise to sustainability concerns, and at what point does council borrowing become a problem? As you pointed out earlier, councils have increased their level of borrowing in recent years.
I think at this point, I would just want to make the comparison between Scotland and England. In Scotland, local authorities have got big problems, but that basically relates to resource shortage. The problem in England is quite different. The local audit system collapsed in England after the abolition of the Audit Commission and the abolition of district audit. Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland did not do the same things and do not have comparable problems. Local authorities in Scotland have got a generally good record of getting their accounts out, getting unqualified accounts, though that is not to be complacent about the fact that there are certain delays at some councils. So the other point about England is there was lots of a small number of councils, but very prominent now in the news councils, actually invested in commercial enterprise, commercial type property developments, to some extent encouraged by the UK government at the time. Those went sour. And that has very much affected the environment within which English local authorities work. So Scotland is very different in that sense. It doesn't have those problems. Where it does have some comparability would be the question of historic equal pay claims, whereby you're getting sale and lease back of facilities by some councils in order to be able to pay for equal pay claims. And that is one of the common features, say, between Glasgow and Birmingham.
OK, thanks. Bill?
Just to pick up the point about single status, which was introduced just about the, was agreed just about the time I became a chief executive, and to highlight the point that David's making about having to think through capital programmes and think through expenditure. One of my biggest criticisms when I made the move from being a central civil servant, whose final job, interestingly, was in local government division and making the capital allocations, becoming a chief executive, was the amount of legislation that we got through which said there are no resource implications. This is not true. Every single piece of legislation has some kind of resource implication, even if it's only that your lawyers have to crawl all over it to work out what it means. It might be as simple as that, but it's very seldom the case. And single status was a classic illustration of a national policy worked through, and I don't dispute it. It was a perfectly good thing. It went through the courts, and as public sector employers, we were grateful for it. But nobody anywhere thought it through properly. And that is a good example of what David is saying is happening all the way down through the whole capital planning process. So I realise that's not a capital planning issue, but I'm raising it as a policy development issue, mm-hmm. which is really what we're talking about here. Because if you don't look over the horizon, you don't think it through properly, you don't see the consequences, and to pick up Alison's point, and you don't pick up what's going to happen at community level and get some kind of feedback coming back up of what it actually means on the ground, mm-hmm. because the difference for me from a civil servant, from moving from a Scottish level to the third smallest council in Scotland and the poorest council in Scotland and an independent council was quite dramatic. And it's important that we recognise, you know, one size does not fit all.
Mm. Yeah, that is certainly the case. Alison?
In terms of the debt, councils' hands are tied. You've got hugely increasing demands for services, a cost of living crisis, attempts to try and look at prevention as well as firefighting crises, at the same time as a council tax freeze. And a growing inability to increase revenue from any other sources. And if that continues, the debt levels will rise, the financial sustainability of the councils will get worse, or the services will implode. There won't be the much-needed community-based services that are required. So there is a perfect storm there, and it needs intervention.
OK. Thanks very much. And you mentioned the council tax freeze, and I'm going to bring in Pam Gosol, who has an area of interest there. Pam, come on in.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. It is the Meerkats Group view that the Scottish Government's decision to freeze council tax has an impact on the financial sustainability of councils. Could witnesses explain why they make this statement? And because the local authority executives I have met with, and that was 31 councils I met with, expressed concerns that the freeze really pushed their budgets to their limits. If a similar policy is pursued next year, what could the impact be on local government finances? Could I ask Bill the question first, then go on to Professor David and maybe Alison then?
Certainly. I confess I'm struggling just to think through what you actually said. Our statement was that we didn't think the council tax freeze itself had a great impact on sustainability because, frankly, it's been there for many years and it probably was pretty well factored in. And anyway, to some degree, the financial effects were mitigated. But there isn't any doubt at all that the imposition of that freeze in the way it was done, a complete breach of the Verity House Agreement, as we said in a report, is just revisiting the past. It's exactly what happened to Neil McIntosh's report in 1999. Fine words followed by actions which don't comply with them. So what will happen in the future? I think actually Alison and David have already picked up about what's going to happen. And I think I'd reinforce one point that David made in particular. It's also made in the local government information unit paper that you've got very forcibly. And that is the impact of freezing council tax for 10, 12 years means that you have effectively reduced the tax base. So when the councils do actually get round or get given freedom to start increasing it, they're starting from a base which is 10 to 12 years out of date. It is reduced. And the long-term impact of that, as David vividly demonstrated in his opening contribution, I thought, was that we are actually transferring the tax burden from local to central government and therefore onto the general levels of income tax. And we are missing out on lots and lots of other possibilities, some not all of which are relevant to every area of Scotland, let's be clear. But the councils do not have the freedom to take advantage of the things that can do. And just to finish off with a little anecdote, in the last few years, my old council area has suddenly developed a cruise liner facility. And that's made a huge change to the small economy that they have. But that is very, very dependent on, obviously, the tourism and the world trade and so on, and also makes a big impact on the infrastructure on the island. So why can't the Western Isles and indeed other areas that have these cruise ship facilities be given the facility of charging the people that are coming on? And after I should explain, I've just come off a cruise. So I have witnessed this firsthand, where several thousand people arrive in a place and they all climb on buses and run around and look at the countryside or the city or wherever they're at, and then they get back on the cruise because everything's paid for. So you're not going to spend money when you go ashore, but the buses are still there and they're congesting the cities and that's a little anecdote just to illustrate what I'm trying to say. I hope I've addressed the question, but I confess in the way you framed it, I was a bit unclear about what you've taken out of the statement that we had in our paper. Does that help, Pam?
It does, Bill. No, thank you.
Could I come in now? Clearly, one of the effects of 9 years of council tax freeze has been to diminish the proportion of local authority spending that's actually raised by council tax, which is the main tax local authorities have got. I think I've already made positive reference to the SPICE briefing that's been done for the committee. I think where that should be followed up is to try and establish data on the comparability of council tax in Scotland and in England. Over the last month, I've heard two different comparisons made, and it illustrates how difficult making comparisons is. The first one was by Ivan McKee, the Minister for Public Finance, on any questions, who said that council tax on average was £350 less in Scotland than in England. Kenneth Gibson, the chair of the Public Finance and Administration Committee of this Parliament, said last week that Band D council tax is £700 less in Scotland than in England. Now, those comparisons are problematic because the structure of the property market is actually quite different between Scotland and England, and also Band D in Scotland is a different level of valuation than Band D in England. Houses in Band D in Scotland would not be in Band D in England. So I think getting systematic data together on comparisons would help to illustrate the point I made at the very beginning, is that we've got this kind of really unplanned shift from kind of property taxation to income taxation. And I'm on the public record as saying that I think in terms of deviation, of divergence of income tax from the rest of the UK has probably reached its limit. So that certainly if the Scottish Parliament wants more resources, I think that property taxation is going to have to be looked at. I chaired a Royal Society of Edinburgh working party which submitted evidence to the Scottish Government on the question of the tweaking of council tax bans. And I would commend that advice paper to the committee as suggesting the way in which one could go forward with council tax change. I think it's very one of the points which I would emphasise personally is that if there is going to be a council tax revaluation, the Parliament has got to be very clear about whether this is just redistributing the tax burden more appropriately because the 1991 values are ridiculously out of date, or whether it is intended to generate more revenue from that. I think in terms of the political presentation of the policy, it's very clear to be established whether the idea is to get more revenue or whether it's just to rebalance who pays council tax. Broadly, one of the things that's quite remarkable in the last 35 years is the shift of economic prosperity generally from the west of Scotland to the east of Scotland. So in broad terms, property in the east of Scotland is undervalued, property in the west of Scotland is overvalued.
Alison.
I think we would certainly agree that we would disagree with the previous council tax freeze, and if there was any suggestion to try and have another council tax freeze. I think that, yes, there's the public perceptions around about a council tax freeze, because obviously telling people that their council tax is going to be frozen is a good thing. People like hearing that. People don't necessarily understand that by freezing the council tax, that will have a detrimental impact on local services. And what is the overall impact on that? Because they're hearing a message from the Scottish Government about their council tax freeze, but it's the local authorities that are delivering those services. I think there would be some disquiet and outrage if Westminster tried to impose an income tax freeze on the Scottish rate of income tax. It doesn't make sense. It's going across, but it's exactly the same because it's one tier of government trying to control and exert power on what is supposed to be a local tax. And should one local authority want to put up taxes and justify to its electorate why it is doing that, then it should be perfectly entitled to do so. But I think the disconnect between what people are paying, the fact that they're paying on property rates from the 90s, I think it's not a great statement about 25 years of devolution that we've got a council tax freeze that nobody seems to like, that is widely discredited, is seen as regressive, but we've been completely unable to change it or to reform it. It can't be beyond the wit of the Scottish Parliament and devolution to fix this problem. Yes, there's the review groups, but we've had them before. We've had local authority committees before. And I think in our evidence, we quoted the local government committee of 2002 saying that they wanted to see local government finance shift from this 80-20 split to more of a 50-50 split. We're going backwards. We're not going forwards. We're nowhere near 50-50. And we would certainly want to see greater movement in that direction.
When people pay council tax, they're also paying the Scottish water rate, which is about Scottish water. And most members of the public don't actually recognise that that is a different organisation. And I think if you look at what's happened since 1996, when that began to operate in that way, it's grown immensely at the same time that council tax has been frozen for many years. And I think maybe that's another of these effects of splitting and creating new organisations, which then have the benefit of the councils collecting, and I'd say very efficiently for the most part, the way that council tax is collected. However, all the comments that have been made previously highlight what is wrong with council tax at the moment, but it is worthwhile remembering that Scottish water rates are in there as well.
Thanks. Pam.
Thank you, convener, and thank you, panel, for your responses there. I've got one more question. Last week, the Local Government Information Unit told us that ring fencing is a particular issue for Scottish local government. Do you believe that the Scottish Government to continue with ring fencing in this year's local government settlement?
Fencing, either as a civil servant or as a council chief executive. It picks up exactly the point Alison's just made about one tier of government imposing its will on another. It seems to me that one of the lessons of the last 25 years is that it's time to look not just at local authorities, but to look at the whole way Scotland is governed and the relationships. And the Parliament should be strategic And the government, if it wants to be a government, should be a government and not an administration. Don't think I can put it in simpler terms. I answer the Layfield question in that manner. And 50-50 to me is not even getting near what I think should be the case. But how we take that forward is an entirely different matter, Pam. Keith, what do you think?
Well, I just add something, which is it's about local communities. And one of the effects of the ring fencing is that councils don't have the flexibility to be able to spend in ways that represent local priorities. And that's not just about the council itself. It's about all the communities who deserve the opportunity to have their priorities set. And I think what's happened since ring fencing increased is that too many communities are now finding that they are limited in their ability to be able to spend. And I know that across Scotland we've got some really good examples of development trusts that have done some amazing things, and they very often got Scottish Government grants in order to do that. But I think there's so much more potential there, simply as a result of that there are now, maybe this is looking ahead a little bit, but there's so many more people working from home, working in their communities, networking in their communities, understanding the local issues. And they ought to be given the opportunity to be able to take decisions at a more local level than the local authority. And this goes back to Bill's comment earlier on about what Donald Dewar said, because when the Scottish Parliament was set up, he talked about devolution not just being coming to what is now Holyrood from Westminster. He talked about it, you know, passing down to local authorities or the lowest level where decision-making could be taken. And I think what we're talking about in ring fencing is one of the ways in which that is going in the opposite direction. And I would love to see the opportunity across Scotland of allowing a thousand flowers to bloom in the local communities by giving them that opportunity.
Thanks. Okay. Colette, I think you want to come in on a supplementary.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning, panel. So I'm going to kind of flip this round a wee bit in terms of your comments on ring fencing, in the respect that you touched upon it, Professor Heald, in terms of reckless decisions that have been made within some local authorities, more so you mentioned down south. But also recently I done a government-initiated question on reserves within each local authority, and some of them were particularly significant in terms of some of the reserves that are being held at local authority level. Can I ask you to comment on that?
Could I first come back and say that my reference to reckless behaviour related to England, not to Scotland. I think that Scotland, that despite the difficulties we've been pointing to, the Scottish local government system has been better governed than England has. So because of the Accounts Commission Audit Scotland and because of the Scottish government itself, those things haven't repeated. The English behaviour hasn't repeated in Scotland, and the auditing system hasn't collapsed. On the point about reserves, I found the Spice briefing paper really helpful, a point I've made several times. But I think one has to be careful about reserves. I find it quite difficult to understand the data that I've seen. I understand the difference between unusable reserves and usable reserves. Unusable reserves, an example, would be revaluation of property, which is essentially an accounting transaction. On the usable reserves, there's a distinction between the earmarked reserves and the un-earmarked reserves. And the Accounts Commission's pointed, and COSLA have pointed to the importance of that quite relatively small number across Scotland as a whole, highly very much differentiated by local authorities of the usable unmarked reserves. But that raises the question of what earmarked actually means. Earmarked might be something where you've got a legal or contractual obligation to spend the money in a particular way. It could also mean that the Chief Executive Director of Finance, the Council, has decided to put some money aside. The US is fond of talking about rainy day funds to deal with particular problems. So the question, well, one of my questions would be, when you look at the variation across councils, is to what extent is this a classification issue, that people are classifying things differently, or whether it reflects a genuine difference, because the SPICE briefing does show very big differences in the reported usable reserves across councils. So I think it's very important to not just concentrate at the Scotland level, but actually to think about what happens across the 32 councils.
Okay. I don't know if anyone else would like to come in on that.
Am I allowed a slightly light-hearted view of this?
Yes.
If I am. You must have heard the tale of the chair sitting in on the appointment of a new director of finance. And he says, waits till the end. As each gets to the end, he asks each of them, what's 2 plus 2? And the first three candidates say 4. And the next candidate says, what do you want it to be? It's a little joke from the accountancy world. It's told at dinners. I'm sure it's old hat. That just illustrates the point that David is making about is how you classify things. And one council, chief executive, director of finance, gives advice to the council, and the council takes a view that there is something that they know is going to happen in 5 years' time. When do you start putting that into your budgets? When does it come into your... And that's going to vary. Now, the other little anecdote, and I do mean this in a light-hearted sense, I don't know if there's any members of the media here, but one of the horrors I found when I became a council chief executive was the annual trailing in the red tops. When the reserve figures were published for, it was usually late April or May. And we were always castigated for having huge reserves. Why was that? Well, I'll tell you, I've been inside central government and local government, and I can tell you why. Because central government, moving to the end of its financial year, offloads all of its spare cash as fast as it can out to all the other agencies. Why? And here you get to another point that you need to think about very carefully when you're dealing with any of this. It's the incentive. If you're sitting in a central government department doling out grants and it's getting to the end of the year and you find you're heading for an underspend, you want to get that money out the door. Why? Because if you've got an underspend this year, you'll not get that money next year. And that's the kind of games that go on inside the system. I'm not giving away any secrets here, by the way. I think we all know that this is what goes on. So the consequence of that was that every year when we closed our books at the end of our financial year, we had reserves. And a lot of those reserves, not all of it, and it would vary from council to council, picking up David's point, would vary greatly from council to council. But a lot of them, in some cases, was money that had been shunted out. And it was really money in advance of need, which really shouldn't happen. Really shouldn't happen, as you're probably well aware of that. But it does, because that's the incentive in the system. So I hope that gives a bit of an elaboration on what some of the difficulties that David has more eloquently than I have done. And can I say also, just to commit, I thought the SPICE briefing on this was very good. And I noticed also that the Accounts Scotland are saying that they're actually going to have a look at this to try and give greater clarity on the matter of what is usable and unusable and what is contingency and so on.
OK, thank you.
Thanks very much for that. I'm going to bring in Fulton McGregor, who's also joining us online. He's got a number of questions. Fulton.
That's me now. Thank you very much, Convener. It was a wee problem with unmuting myself there, which I think has been my fault and not those controlling the system. Thank you very much, Convener, for bringing me in, and good morning to the panel. I wanted to ask about the issue, which is obviously gets a lot of media attention every year, and that is around about the pay settlement for local government workforce. Given the stats that we've got, that say that local government employment amounts to around 70% of the revenue budgets, what do you think as a panel needs to happen for pay deals to be managed more sustainably and strategically next year and, of course, moving forward? And as I'm not in the room, I'm happy for the convener to sort of convene, if you like, who answers and in what order.
Anybody want to come in on that one?
Come in, Alison. For it. Just from our view, that's it's another huge financial issue that the local authorities are facing, but it is part of the broader issue of the financial sustainability, and it can't be taken apart from the bigger issues about where they're getting their money from and their sustainability and the looking at the council tax, looking at local government finance and as a whole, and the general discussion, as others have pointed out, about what are the responsibilities and powers of local authorities. And as part of that, so I think if it's a local government responsibility, then the local authorities have to have the powers and the responsibilities to be able to address that. So rather than we necessarily look at each individual issue, but looking at it as a bigger issue, looking at it strategically, because there is the paid settlements, there are also issues in terms of the social care problems, there are issues around about greater need and demand, where vulnerable individuals, the sort of different problems that are coming, our demographics are changing, all have an impact in different ways on local government finance. And rather than perhaps looking at each individual issue, it needs more of a strategic standing back and saying, well, these problems are all coming, what do we need to do? And I think there needs to be a far greater discussion around about what are the responsibilities of local authorities, what is our system of governance, and therefore, if these are the responsibilities, how can we ensure local authorities are able to meet those fiscal demands?
Thanks for that. Any other views on the workforce, the demands of local government workforce settlements? Yeah. Keith?
I think we also need to look at what's happened to the local government workforce over the years. The 70% is perhaps less important than the fact that because pay settlements going back 10, 15 years have been below the rate of inflation, it's become increasingly difficult to attract key professional staff into local government. And at the same time, most local authorities have managed to make redundant by various mechanisms a whole tranche of people who take away with them the institutional memory of the local authority. And it's very evident, I've done quite a bit of work over the last 10 years or so mentoring or coaching different directors and chief executives. And one of the things that's very apparent from those discussions is the fact that management structures, and it's unusual to say this, are far too tight in local government now. You've got people managing vast swathes of services without necessarily having the experience of the service or the people below them who've got that experience to be able to manage effectively. And I do think one of the predicaments we have is that compared to, and with the discussion we had earlier on about many of the national organisations, some of the loosely called quangos, they've managed to be able to retain many of the staff in the way that local government has been dispensing with them. So I think the real issue about the whole of this is that the 70% is not an unreasonable amount, and the issue for the future is can local government afford to go any tighter in terms of its structures in delivering the services that need to take place?
Okay. Thanks very much for that. Bolton, do you want to come in with your next question?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I want to thank the panel for those answers. I wanted to turn to Professor Heald, who states that that the equalisation methods used to distribute funding means that perhaps that Scotland is not realising the full benefit of these. I wonder if he could expand a wee bit on that and what he thinks could be done in this year's budget to address the issue.
I think there's been a long-term shift away from having full resource equalisation across Scotland. One of the things that, to go back to a point I made earlier, there's been lots of short-term measures which then become permanent. So the idea of the equalisation system on resources is that basically each council should have the ability to deliver a comparable level of service to its population. The way in which the system has operated, that is no longer the case. Some councils are above that level. That becomes very important in terms of talking about any change to councils' tax powers, either council tax or other taxes, because very clearly some taxes that might be new would generate a lot more revenue in some authorities than it would in others. So, I mean, if we just take a realistic example of the tourist tax, the tourist tax will generate more money in Edinburgh and the Highlands than it will in certain parts of the west of Scotland. My understanding is that there will be some provision within the grant system for compensating for the transient population. So when you get a new tax, you've got the problem. First of all, that some councils will get much more per head from that new tax than others. And secondly, if there's been any compensation for their different positions in the past, whether the grant system changes. So that if there was a council tax revaluation, my expectation would be that the individual values and the cumulative total values in the east of Scotland would tend to go up and the west of Scotland would tend to go down. What is going to happen to the grant system as a consequence? So any kind of council tax revaluation, any additional tax for local authorities has got to, at the same time, think through how the broader finance system operates.
Bill, come on.
Just a lesson from the past. Sorry, I did say earlier we're the dinosaurs, so we've got long memories. If Greg and the Spice team want to dig back far enough to the 1996 reorganisation, you'll find that quite a few councils took umbrage at the distribution settlement at that time. And there was a two-year exercise in which it was all done. It was called the Mismatch Councils. Remember them, Keith? my memory was that after 2 years and everybody pressed the button on the revised model, less than 0.5% of the total was actually moved around. Because when you move into the kind of system that David's just described, you are moving into a system where there's a great deal of, a very large number of variables all to be considered. We've got primary indicators and secondary indicators and all sorts of things like that. I'm glad I'm out of it now, to be honest. I see the advisors nodding. You're remembering, are you? Yes. So it is complicated, but David is absolutely right. But can I just throw this question out to you at a generally sort of philosophical level? Is it such a bad thing that at some appropriate level that you have different levels of taxation and maybe even some places that have got the ability to raise taxes get a little more than others? I mean, or are we going to go down the line of saying, well, it's all national? I mean, there is an issue there, to go back to your earlier question, Fulton, about pay. I mean, most councils are signed into national pay agreements. Is that really totally appropriate? I just raised the question. Glad I'm not around to answer it.
Okay, thank you very much for that. And we'll take those questions on board and see what we can do about that. But I do think that there's been earlier comments about the desire to have decisions made at the most local level, and that's the direction of travel in the good words of Donald Dewar. So maybe that's got an answer in there. We're going to move on to an area of financial sustainability and different income-raising options. And I'm going to invite Willie Coffey to start us off there.
Yeah, thanks very much, convener, and good morning, everybody. Could we just kind of briefly run back to financial sustainability for a wee minute and try to compare and contrast what happened in England with what could happen, if it's possible, in Scotland? We've referred to some of the reckless behaviours down south that led to that. Could I ask you, do you think that recklessness came about as a result of the general power of competence being granted to England's local authorities? We don't have that in Scotland. I'm going to ask you that in a minute, whether you think we need something like that in Scotland. But did it come about as a result of that, do you think? The council's out investing in the private sector and so on and so forth and running up huge debts. And we had some spectacular examples last week of how badly it all went. So what caused it? Was it that general power of competence being devolved?
Not sure, Willie. The basic question is that if we're arguing that local government should have more responsibility and more powers, that will be consistent with what's happened down there. I think the question then is, given those responsibilities, can the local authority use them effectively? And this comes back to the trust in local government. And one could argue at the moment that trust in local government, you've only got to look at the household survey to realise that it's diminished, and it's diminished almost as fast as the Scottish Parliament's satisfaction levels have diminished in the recent surveys. So one of the questions I think that we must consider in this is that is it wrong that decisions are made like this, which then can be checked by the democracy, the local democracy that exists there? And I'm sure in the authorities that David has talked about that have gone wrong, it will have significant changes in what will the voting patterns in the future and the operation of those authorities. The fact it's gone too far is very unfortunate, but we live in difficult times at the moment. But on your basic question, sorry, I can't really say whether it's a matter of the competence being at the height of this.
Yeah. I mean, we've got Professor Hield.
I'm not sure about the answer, direct answer to your question about the power of general competence. My understanding is that that doesn't exist in Scotland, but it did in England. This was part of the localism agenda of Eric Pickles when he was the Communities Secretary in England. Essentially, the point was massively cut local authority resources and tell them to be entrepreneurial. It was also linked in to the two-tier structure in England, with district councils with relatively few functions and quite small budgets. What I was describing as reckless behaviour was going to the Public Works Loans Board, which is actually part of the Treasury, and borrowing money at sub-private market rates to invest in property, sometimes in their own jurisdiction and sometimes elsewhere. I think that the reason why that got so out of control is that district audit had been abolished and the audit commission had been abolished. If the reporting mechanisms that existed in the 2000s had existed in the 2010s, I think those problems would have been identified much quicker, because the audit commission would have certainly produced reports about the vulnerability of these councils. So I think that the point I tried to make in my opening remarks is that there are big differences between the situation in Scotland and in England. The commonality is the resource shortage and the competing demands that local authorities face. Where I think I differ from the Murcutt Group evidence is I'm probably more centralist than they are. The point about councils like Woking or Thurrock, UK local authorities and public bodies cannot go bankrupt. There is not the private market mechanism. If a private company goes bankrupt, like Carillion, the shareholders lose their money. If a public body like a local authority goes bankrupt, it's very unlikely the UK or Scottish governments would actually let a local authority go bankrupt, because it would damage the credit rating and the reputation of the UK and Scottish governments and other local authorities. So you actually get the question is that if a council like Woking or Thurrock undertakes reckless investments, loses large amounts of money, what actually happens next? The Liberal Democrats have now taken control of Woking from the Conservatives. Now, do you shut down all local services in Woking? I mean, it's basically not a practical proposition. So that my view is there has to be proper governance at the central level. The question is getting that governance to be proportional.
Really fascinating response to that. I mean, there's been some similar examples over the years in Scotland where the word brokerage comes into play. You know, colleges got brokerage when they had some deficit. NHS health boards got that over the years too. And maybe that's a smaller example of stepping in to resolve an issue so that you don't fail to deliver services, perhaps. But we also heard that story last week, Professor Hield, about the failure of the Accounts Commission. But we're also aware that internal audit didn't disappear and vanish overnight. These councils, like Woking, that racked up their £2 billion deficit, they must have had internal audit scrutiny of what they were doing. And either it was roundly ignored or they just weren't on the ball. with that. So, I mean, if we decide to do something like you're suggesting in Scotland and devolve power to the local administrations and devolve fiscal responsibility, are we at risk of ending up in the same place as Woking? Could that happen if we do that? We can call it a general power of competence if you like, or we could call it something else, devolving further power to local government. Is there a risk there? So how do we protect ourselves against those outcomes that happened in places like Woking from happening in Scotland?
I mean, I think I've probably already answered the point that I do believe that the UK government and the Scottish government have actually got responsibilities for public sector as a whole. So the local authorities are going to operate within a set of constraints. So simply because in practical terms, neither the UK nor Scottish governments can afford their public bodies to go bust. In fact, there isn't actually a mechanism for either countries to go bust or public bodies to go bust in the sense that actually happens in the private sector.
Alison? I think it's also worth, as we've said, you know, powers have been sucked up from local authorities. They did have more powers. Yes, I think quite a few of us would like to see powers beyond just council tax devolved to local authorities, but they did previously have proper control of the council tax. There have been, through ring fencing and the council tax freezes, powers have been removed. Through other areas and responsibilities, powers have been removed. Local authorities did have, in Scotland, more powers than they've got at the moment. They did have greater financial controls. Yes, it would be fantastic to get towards a 50-50, but going back to where we were in 2002, it would still be an improvement where we are now. So I think the idea that we're talking about the risks when we did have that system, they did have more powers. It's not something that's brand new. I think it's, again, yes, it's about trusting that there needs to be checks and balances. But I would certainly want to challenge the idea that we can't devolve powers because they might make bad decisions. Because I think, unfortunately, and whilst I would disagree with them, we've heard Westminster politicians make the same comments about decisions that have been made by this Parliament. I think that's about democracy, it's about localisation, making sure there's checks and balances and there's a proper system of governance there, but also recognising if we want proper local services that take account of those differing needs, we need those powers to be controlled locally. And that's a risk if we don't. I mean, there are risks both ways. Yes, the risks you talk about, but what about the risks to communities and to the services who aren't getting access to what they need?
Okay. Are you saying that Scottish councils shouldn't have the same, or should have the same powers as Woking had?
We certainly want to see far more permissible powers given to local authorities, yes.
Sure. I think the important points that are coming out, and both Alison and David have made them, which is that, first of all, you're absolutely right to identify that as a risk, and that's a risk no matter what happens. But as David has outlined, provided you have the correct checks and balances in place, then due process can be followed. And due process is an important phrase. I would suggest, however, that the way to look at this is to come at it from an entirely different perspective. And that's where we as the Merkit Group are arguing that what we need to do is not get hung up on what the current powers, what the current systems are, but stand back and look at the principles of how do we want Scotland to be governed, and more important, how do we want public services to be delivered? And you're quite right, then that kind of risk that you've identified can be handled in a proper way, having regard to, now we've argued that a good starting point is to go back to Wheatley, because there are basic principles there which we think stand the test of time. They have to be applied in the current system, but if you go back, even the extracts that we provided in our paper help to answer your question, because it's about words like accountability, it's about taking decisions at the lowest possible level consistent with democratic and financial accountability. That's what it's about. So I think the more important point here is, yes, these are risks, but they have to be taken into consideration in a much wider debate and context about how we actually want to govern Scotland.
Yeah, so it's finally, the checks and balances is probably the key to it, isn't it?
Come back in. I wouldn't want local authorities to become property investors in other jurisdictions. First of all, they're not diversified like a private property developer would be. Secondly, the English councils were getting access to the Public Works Loans Board at below market rates, so it was unfair competition against the private sector. The other point that I would wish to make is that local elections are not largely fought on local matters. Local elections are very much dominated by UK or Scottish level issues. So the accountability mechanism that some people would argue clearly exists between electors and their local councils is flawed by the way in which local elections have now become very much national contests of popularity and by the question of turnout. So I very much want to see Scotland govern better. That would involve more powers for local authorities, but I think there are limits on how far one wants to go.
Yeah, could I just maybe slightly disagree with David on this? Because when I was a chief executive, I used to analyse the election results at the local level, the council elections, and it was very apparent that, I hesitate to say this, that knowing the councillors, if you had a good councillor who was working very hard in their community, they inevitably did better than the councillor who was not working at that same level. So whilst I think David's right, at the general level, it reflected some national trends, but at the local level, there was a huge discrepancy between the ability of a councillor to have actually performed in their locality, and that did count for a lot. And I don't think we ought to dismiss, and you know, to my mind, this is an important part of local democracy, the understanding that, and people tend to know their local councillors better because they represent a smaller community.
Just my final point, Ariane, was that the checks and balances issue that you've all mentioned are probably the key to protecting against those particular types of outcome. If we can agree that the principles are sound to devolve as much power as we can, we'd all agree with that. But the checks and balances, particularly in Scotland, around audit and the Accounts Commission internal audit, that for some reason that we don't know, seem to desert our colleagues in places like Woking, are quite stark. So if that's a positive note, and to finish that conversation.
I've got more confidence in external audit when done properly than I have in internal audit. Internal audit is too vulnerable to management pressure.
Presumably there's evidence of that in Woking. Thank you very much, Camilla.
Thanks very much, Billy. Okay, I'm just going to do a little bit of time awareness here. We are a little over halfway through our questions. I think we'll be fine, but if we can keep our questions and answers a bit more succinct, that would be great, although it is a very rich discussion. And just so colleagues know, I'm going to bring in people in the following order. So I'm going to bring in Colette, and then Pam, and then I'll go to Mark.
Colette. Okay, thanks, convener. I'm going to come on to PFI contracts and what challenges and opportunities does the ending of PFI contracts within the actual schools present at a local authority level, if you want to come in on that, Bill.
In theory, let's go back. If we go back to when PFI and then what became PPP was first developed, the theory was that when the contract came to an end, the council was sitting on a spanking, up-to-date, wonderful asset that now would have a revenue stream available to it to spend on lots of other things, including continuing the maintenance of it. Roll on 25 years and financial crisis and 15 years of austerity and all the rest of it, and you've already had from us today, and I'm sure from every other witness you've ever had and every submission you've ever had, the realities facing local government is a very different climate. So that's point number one. Point number two, my direct experience was in the Western Isles. It was not a happy experience. The Scottish Government spent, my understanding, several hundred thousand pounds on consultants to try and work something out that would actually fit the model. And that, to go back to Willie's important point, this is something that I think has been symptomatic across UK government, and probably other governments, over the last 30 years, which is compliance with financial strictures and conditions in order to hit certain debt targets. I don't know how many of you will remember Gordon Brown's efforts to lower the public sector debt because we were aspiring to join the euro at that time. Halcyon days. And that was one of the reasons why the PFI became the PPP. And in essence, I'll be quite brutal about it, in my view, and behind the scenes, I told my council this. I said, they're bending the rules here. They bent the rules to create something in the Western Isles. And at the time we did it, on the financial analysis we did it, we forecast a black hole in year 13, if I remember, on a 38-year contract. Now, I can't speak for other councils. That's the one PPP that I was deeply, deeply involved in, and I was very unhappy about it because at the end of the day, my councillors, and I had a very, very good collective mind council. It's one of the great privileges of my life to have sat in my council and watch politicians react with one another and reach a collective view. They were very good at that, and I'm sure that's true of other councils. My councillors were given the best advice we could give them, and they still took it, and they took it because, I quote, it was the only game in town. And so I fear, based on my experience and based on my reading that I've done, and I've got a little bit of bibliography for you if you want to follow this up, there's a book called Bean Counters. And the author's name's just Richard, the name's escaping me at the moment, but he's the financial journalist for Private Eye. And he has spelled it out in detail. The whole sorry saga of PFI, the financial crisis of Lehman, it's all there, laid out for you in stark detail, and it goes back exactly to the point that Willie was raising and the one that you were raising earlier, which is what happens when you classify things in certain ways, and what happens when someone comes along to the director of finance and says, what's 2 plus 2, and he says, what do you want it to be? So it's not a helpful answer to you because sitting from where I am, I'm not in the system anymore. I can't speak for the people that are looking at this, but I do know that the chief executives and directors of finance and all the people responsible for the schools and all the other things that are doing it will be looking precisely over the horizon to when these contracts run out. And as I say, in theory, 30 years ago, 25 years ago, that should have meant you suddenly had 2 or 3 million, maybe in my case, if I remember rightly, the final year's payment was 3.8 million. Now, the Western Isles budget at that time was only about 120 million. So you're looking at apparently getting 3% of your revenue funding available to you 30 years down the line. I suspect that's not going to be the case.
Okay, that's really helpful, and I'll certainly look up that book that you quoted.
I'll try and remember the name, because I'll speak to you at the end.
Okay, thank you.
Richard Brooks.
Brooks, you're quite right, thank you.
Okay, David. That's lovely. Professor Hill, would you like to come in and comment on the PFI?
Given the time constraints, PFI is a very big topic. The issue that's arising is the school's handback is going to come. I think Falkirk is quite soon. I think Glasgow is about 7 years. One of the big issues there is going to be what actually happens to maintenance. People privately will tell you that maintenance on PFI schools is better than maintenance on the council's own schools, because maintenance on council's own schools is vulnerable to budget cutbacks. So one of the questions will be what actually happens to the quality of maintenance of those PFI schools after the handback.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm now going to bring in Pam Gosell.
Thank you, convener. Last week, it became public that the UK government had paused the £70 million rural growth deal for Argyll and Bute, leaving it the only part of Scotland without such a deal in place. This deal was of great importance to Argyll and Bute, as it included housing, developments and facilities for business and tourism. What impact might this have on the area, and what steps would witnesses suggest the Scottish Government take to mitigate this?
OK, who wants to have a go at that one? Come on, Bill.
Well, I'll let Keith come in. But Keith was chief executive of Stirling, which many people forget has a very large rural hinterland, so he's quite used to rural issues. Obviously, I was chief executive of the Western Isles, so I'm very familiar with the issues that they will be facing in Argyll and Bute. You asked us to be brief. I'll be very brief. I thought that what the UK government did in terms of the city initiative was outrageous and contradicts all the things that we've been arguing about people being left to do what they're doing. In effect, post-Brexit, the then Prime Minister, I'm not going to use the name, in essence reinvented the European structural funds, but he branded them as the UK. I was amazed to see even the simple things like requiring flags to be flown at projects and signs put up is the very thing that as an administration, a Conservative administration in the 90s, they railed against. I should say, Chair, I used to be head of the European Structural Funds Division in the Scottish office, so I have some direct knowledge of this. As to the effect it will have in the area, I suspect it's the same effect it has on anyone that's developing a complex project for a rural area. Your major funding source is pulled on you. What do? Well, you've done all the development work. You go back to the drawing board, you take all that work, you take it forward and you go somewhere else and you find other ways of raising the money. What can the Scottish Government do? Well, the simple thing to do is to give them the money, but we've all heard the evidence, that's not going to be easy. So the alternative is to take a longer-term view and maybe when this committee reports and the budget settlement comes out, we'll find alternative ways of dealing with capital issues. The only point I would on the horizon I think might be bright for everyone is that if I read the Financial Times correctly, and David will be more up to date on this than I am, the current UK Chancellor seems to be talking about bending the rules again. So maybe that actually the capital tap will reopen, but if it does, you can bet it will come with a whole series of constraints and limitations.
Thanks very much. Anybody else got a thought on the... Keith? Yeah.
Just a quick issue on Argyll, because I recall when I worked in Strathclyde, I was responsible for the European funding back in the 1990s, I guess it was, early 1990s. And one of the great things about it then is that the European commissioners and the senior officers loved coming to Argyll and loved making available funding for Argyll. And that was something you could always phone up and get them to come across, and several million would come at the end of that. I don't think that happens with the UK or even the Scottish government because there's so many other issues to deal with. So one of the real benefits of belonging to the European Union was this ability to be able to generate these additional funds, and that has obviously disappeared now.
Okay. Thanks very much for that. I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Camilla. We had the Local Government Information Unit at committee with us last week, and they talked about the need for councils to have a basket of taxes, a whole range of income raising measures. Just to go across the panel, ask your views on any tax raising powers that you think should be devolved to local authorities, and maybe... You know, we've touched on the balance between local authority funding, an aspiration to go 50-50. But how does Scotland compare to, comparator nations when it comes to the balance of funding being raised locally and nationally for council services? Start with Alison.
We would certainly agree with the Local Government Information Unit, and we would want to see a basket of taxes, but I think we've also said that shouldn't be the case that councils have to come cap in hand to the Scottish Government. You know, whether it's the tourist tax or other kind of things, there should be more permissible powers to allow local authorities to develop schemes that work for their area. Whether it's looking at the cruise ships or something, what is the way that they can raise money locally and address their needs? So I think, yes, a basket of taxes, but also giving them the permissible powers to kind of develop what works in their area. I do think there are because you touched on the Local Government Information Unit, the bit that they mentioned in their evidence as well, which really struck a chord with me, was about the difference in terms of the silos of the budget and the... a negative relationship between health and social care. And I think that's a really important thing, that looking at around the sort of the basket of taxes and the spending, that if we need to do a lot more in social care. It's a local government responsibility. The more you do in social care, you save money in the health service, but that's a different budget. And I think there also needs to be something that is looked at in the round so that how we can encourage. So yes, more tax powers, more responsibility, but equally recognising that that relationship between health and social care is a problem, and we want to encourage local authorities to spend money in these areas, but the savings are found somewhere else in the Scottish Government's budget. And if they don't spend, then there's a cost of another part of the budget. And it's just something that needs to be, I think, a greater awareness made to that as well.
Okay. Professor Hild.
I think the most important issue is about reforming council tax, because that's a big revenue raiser. Non-domestic rates is no longer a local tax. It is basically a national tax distributed as effectively distributed as grant, and I don't see that changing. There may be areas at the margins where local authorities might get more taxes. Tourist taxes being mentioned. I don't know anything about cruise taxes, but I suspect that attempts to save things are local taxes. I've heard proposals about wealth tax being done locally because it would bypass the UK the legislative restrictions on what powers this Parliament has got. I think they would be challenged in the courts by the UK government. So I think basically reforming the system that we've got is the most important priority. And I think that the mess that council tax is now in. I think a residential property tax is an important way to fund local government, but I think it will actually take a long time to recover from the damage that's been done.
My view is that we shouldn't be sitting talking about what taxes local government or local authorities should or shouldn't raise. What we should do is set forward a set of proposals with basic principles, and then allow whatever public body it is to put forward their suggestions for any additional things they get. So if you go back to the tourist tax, we're talking about some parts of Scotland we want to raise a tourist tax. Well, let them argue their case. What we should be doing is setting up some kind of overall scrutiny panel. Excuse me, but I don't think politicians should be on it. I think this is a matter for taxation and efficiency and effectiveness. As politicians, to pick up Willie's earlier point, should certainly be there as the checks and balances and to ensure the accountability is there. But something like the Accounts Commissioner or something else could be the body that says, yes, OK, you've convinced us that you're going to act responsibly, that this tax is relevant, and also to pick up David's point, and we're going to feed it into the grant equalisation system so that you don't get, you know, an unfair advantage over other councils. So I would personally, this is not a Mercat Group view, I should emphasise that. Keith may well have a different view in this. But my view is that the way forward is not to sit here and legislate for councils to raise individual taxes, but rather to let councils, and for that matter other public bodies if they wanted to come and argue that they should be allowed to do this, to put a levy on something or to put something on it. It's the best way of engaging local communities.
Yeah, I think one of the interesting developments in recent years is at the community level, where if you think about the wind farms and the solar farms, communities are getting a regular income as a result of allowing it to take place very often on land which may belong to the community or may have been agreed with the company that's setting up the wind farm or the solar farm. And I think that sort of raises a question about land or development tax. And if you go back to the beginning of my career, when there was a land commission proposed in 1968, that was perceived as a mechanism whereby when planning permissions were given for developments, whether it be housing or commercial development, there ought to be a tax taken on that, which could be directed towards local government in order to get the benefits to pay for the infrastructure that is required to actually allow that development to take place. And it strikes me that maybe there is an occasion to look again at the possibility of that sort of land stroke development tax as a way forward. David's already made the point that property tax is probably the simplest and most reasonable way of bringing in more money. But I think if that's allied to an examination of a land development tax, and just thinking about it at the moment, we all know that every time planning permission is given, there is a huge uplift in the value of the land. And very often there's an awful lot of land banking takes place. When we talk about planning delays at the moment, or we blame the lack of house building on planning alone, I think equally some of the land banking decisions, understandably, private developers they do wish to ensure that the market conditions are right before they develop. So they may keep land for 5, 10, 15 years before they develop it. And the other thing, of course, is what I mentioned right at the beginning, which is that any development depends upon the different infrastructure providers coming in at the right time, and you need to be able to integrate and coordinate that more effectively, which is not happening because local government doesn't have the strength that it had in earlier years when it had more of that responsibility.
Sorry, I was just going to quickly sort of say that I think it's important that when there are any new taxes or reforms of taxes, that they are properly locally controlled tax. I think the one time that the Parliament came close to replacing the council tax was with a supposedly local income tax, but it was centrally set. And I think that whilst there is a danger of passing on additional tax powers, but they're still centrally controlled and centrally set. And I think that's what is key. It has to be locally controlled and locally set taxes.
Another question, probably primarily for you again, Alison. I just wondered if you could give more information on the social bridging finance that you mentioned in your submission, how it's been used elsewhere and what it could potentially achieve here.
I think certainly that there is clearly a challenge facing local authorities as to how you crisis manage and look to the prevention side, and I think that's across the whole public sector, is that we've got a cost of living crisis, and so what funding is available is firefighting. So we're not investing in the preventative schemes that are hugely needed, and everybody seems to have been in agreement since Christie we should be doing. And so what we are suggesting is that we need to look at some way of, if you have a limit on resources, are there different ways of doing it? So we pointed to social impact investing, social bridging finance as different ways and schemes that could be looked at as a way of trying to invest, pilot, analyse effective early intervention and prevention methods. So the one that we pointed to in our evidence referred to the MCR pathways that worked in Glasgow and looking at educational outcomes. The key with that, the bridging finance model, was that it's philanthropic money working with third sector and a public sector delivery partner, but with a contract that says that should all the outcomes that are set be met, then it will be picked up by the local authority. So the risk is on the philanthropic side, where they're putting up that initial investment, but it will be picked up. There are other impact investing models where the investment will be paid back, whether it's with or without interest. There are different ways and means of doing this, but it's a way of looking at how we can try out different schemes, how we can at least get these things up on the ground. And so we're saying we're going to have to find some way of finding resource. There have been different models, and I think it's then for different local authorities to find what works with them. The MCR pathways was Glasgow, and it was key there was the contract and ensuring those outcomes are met. And I think it's looking at outcomes and delivery that way.
Thank you. I've got another question, Kavina, but I don't know if you want me to take that at the end.
I'll bring you in at the end. Thanks very much, Mark. Okay, yeah, so we're going to move on to public service reform, continue. We've already started to touch on that. And Verity House Agreement. I'm going to bring in Miles, then Colette, and then Mark.
Thank you, Kavina. Yep, the easy topic of public service reform we'll go on to. So I wanted to ask specifically with regards to the Accounts Commission, who stated that councils urgently need to transform how they deliver services to become financially sustainable. And to ask, how should councils be looking to change how they're delivering services, in your opinion, and what opportunities you think there are to reduce costs and improve efficiency, which haven't maybe been already achieved within local government over the last number of years, and how do you think the Scottish Government can help to actively support that transformation? So, easy topic.
Miles, you should just pick somebody.
I'll start with you, Ali. Bill's been thrown in the deep end a few times.
I think clearly the Accounts Commission today touched on a lot of these things as well. I think there are definitely the different ways that it can be done. One of the areas that we've seen is through the tech side of things and data and admin and what can be done in ways there and across the sort of the public sector. You know, we shouldn't be having 32 different IT systems. I mean, we've got situations that if you look at occupational therapists having access to different data, depending on whether they work for the local authority or whether they work for the health board. Our public services on the tech and computer and digitalisation services are completely all over the place. And that is leading to inefficiencies and the links there. But it's been something that's been aware of for some time and seems to be almost like council tax reform, parked into the too difficult. There are definitely things there where that there is a role for the Scottish Government to be looking at. You know, we shouldn't be developing things like 32 different better ways of providing IT. Equally, there shouldn't be 32 councils doing it and 14 health boards doing it. And then, of course, the myriad of GPs underneath that also having their own IT systems. There are things that have been done, for example, if you look at the NHS app that has been developed and is widely used by most of the population in England, but we don't have, and how that links up with your local authorities and with the health service. There are things that we can learn from elsewhere as well about using, you know, we don't need to reinvent the wheel in Scotland in terms of some of the IT things. That so definite possibilities on the tech side, that I think, and that can be led more centrally. But again, there needs to be a bottom-up deliver of that, but some things can be offered by the centre.
Yeah, I know in many council areas, you know, the sharing of resources, co-location, Police Scotland also have been looking at some of that, where you know you can actually look at your infrastructure being brought together and the costs associated with that. Just wondered if Keith or Bill, that was something your councils ever did, and if that was more to improve services or just through savings.
Maybe two examples that may help on this. When I was working, we set up an experiment. I think it was about 2007, 2008, which was in island authorities like Orkney and Shetland. Orkney was the example we actually used. Could we have common HR, common IT, common finance? And in those areas, you had the colleges, you had the health board. You had the police and various others, and they were all operating separately. So we set up this pilot, and we identified that there could be several million pounds savings just by having a single model like that, and we were ready to go. And it was scuppered because health didn't want to put their system in with the others, an example of where things... And I think that's very often been an example, that there is a willingness... very often from the local authorities to go into this wider set of issues, but most of the other organisations are less willing to do it. They're happy sitting where they are. Within Stirling, for example, we worked very closely with the police and we had a common contact centre where all the queries came in. And then when the police disappeared off, they decided they put the contact centre elsewhere. And we all know what happened to the two people died in the car. Had that been in the local contact centre, the people there would have known what was going on. And this is about better public services, not efficiency. But I think overall, I think that's the main area where you can begin to get the efficiencies by looking at the different public sector organisations and see how some of the savings can be made by bringing those back into what I would prefer to see, a local, democratically accountable system whereby far more services are managed at the local level. And I think what Alison has said about IT and others, yes, there's savings to be made there, but I think a lot has been done over the last 10, 15 years by virtue of what things have had to... In fact, it's gone too far in some areas, and what's missing is the quality and the number of people needed to deliver the best public services, whether that's in social care or in the way that road engineers have disappeared off because there isn't the money to be able to pay for things like that nowadays.
Mm-hmm. Another question I had was in relation to any evidence from, you know, the Christie Commission report. And we've discussed it in many pieces of our work as a committee and the recommendations from that and what changes in how local authorities actually operate do you think has come out of that? And especially around a question of moving towards a preventative model and how local authorities are actually able to do that. And just wondered if you had any examples of that, or where you think actually the principles of Christie were taken on board or weren't, and maybe that comes down to, again, that preventative shift just being very difficult because you've not got a separate budget to do that work. If anyone has any...
I think that the danger, and I think we said in our evidence, is that the preventative stuff is always the first for the budget cuts. And it's quite often the most effective preventative stuff is delivered by third sector partners. And if you're a third sector partner, again, you're at the front line for the cuts. And we've seen that in terms of the news coverage as councils have been struggling with their budgets. So I think that politicians all seem to agree, and we've all had, you know, 13 years of seeing how brilliant Christie is, but I don't think it has actually been properly implemented. And I think it's because we're firefighting, and the firefightings tend to be done by government agencies and the bodies, whereas a lot of the best preventative stuff is through the third sector and social enterprises, and they're the ones that are on the front line for the cuts.
Yeah. Does anyone else have...
Just can I be a bit mischievous? If you really want to make an impact, stop calling it the National Health Service and call it the National Sickness Service. And call councils and third sectors the health service. If you go back in your history, and I'm sorry, I'm being a dinosaur today, but that's because I'm a dinosaur now. If you go back in your history and check up, where were the greatest advances in health? When did it happen? It happened in the 19th century. How did it happen? Because municipalities invested in drains, in water, in sewage, in providing public health, which is another Cinderella service. And Alison is absolutely right. These are the services that are most at discretion. They're the ones that have the least apparent impact because you're investing in a sewage system that's going to run for 50, 60 years. But in the first 15 years, you can get rid of malaria and cholera and tuberculosis and all sorts of things like that. So you just have to look at it from the different end of the telescope and see a different way of doing it. We're putting all our money into keeping people alive, and that we're keeping them alive longer. But what are we doing? We're actually increasing the amount of time that they're being sick. So you'll have had these statistics. I'm sure Spice and others will have presented them to you. We're letting people live longer, but a bigger percentage of their time is spent with the National Health Service. Sorry, call it the National Sickness Service and start from a different perspective. Stop them getting in there in the first place by investing in public health. And that will make a bigger... If you want to reform public services, can I also just... this is one of my little bees in my bonnet. We need to watch our language. It's not about reforming local government. It's not about reforming local authorities. It's about reviewing and resetting how we deliver public services and recognising all the interactions. So I'm going to go off on a rant now, so I'll stop.
OK, I was about to ask about your views on integration of health and social care, but maybe that's... too far. And just finally, and this is my million-dollar question to you, is how do you think, or how would you like to see the Verity House agreement taken forward? We've touched upon the council tax freeze, which was kind of thrown into that conversation when it was just, you know, the ink wasn't even dry on that agreement. And so just wondered if witnesses have any views on why they think it's taking so long, or what you think actually... could be useful to take forward that fiscal framework between government and local authorities on the, you know, principles set out in that agreement as they stand.
The principles are fine. I think, as we said in our evidence, the Verity House agreement in of itself is worthy, but it's words. And I think that the problem is you can't separate it out from what happened with the council tax freeze that followed, which didn't seem to abide by the ideas of respect and working together and collaboration that are in the agreement. But I mean, in terms of, you know, the key ideas about tackling poverty and delivering person-centred services and the transition to net zero, that, yes, those are good and worthy principles, but, I mean, it could be like the Christie Commission. We'll be in 10 years' time talking about the Verity House Agreement, why it's not been implemented. It requires some action, and that requires some sort of, something from the Scottish Government to show that how it's working. And that, as I say, that line that I quoted from the Programme for Government about local authorities pretty much being the delivery arm of government, I'm not sure that links well to the Verity House Agreement.
Anyone else want to?
I would add in the McIntosh report from 1999. It was exactly the same treatment. You know, there was parity of esteem was the phrase that came out of that one that everybody talked about. Nothing came from it. The point about any agreement is that unless there's some kind of sanction or somebody to judge the courts or whatever to take a judgment that you go to, then it's a matter of trust. And as we said in our submission, and I think everyone else has said, it was fine to sign the Verity House Agreement, but so quickly to follow up by doing something that was so clearly in breach of it breaks trust. And if you don't have trust, then you don't have respect, and then where do you go next? What's the point in signing up an agreement with somebody who's liable to break it, that, you know, within weeks? Ask yourself that question, and you get to the central nub of it. So that's why we say what you need to do is to get something that stands back. We need to build a consensus, a cross-party political consensus, better still, a consensus across Scotland, that where we're sitting at the moment is not good, and we need to do something about it. And that's why we use the word reset of public services and keep it as general a level as that to get it started. And then we'll move down into the levels of detail.
Just finally, I think, you know, we've heard a lot about kind of that consensus, about kind of allowing councils to do their own thing. On the flip side of that, most people don't accept a postcode lottery and don't think that's acceptable. And most politicians in this room will have used that word in any portfolio that we've discussed or taken forward. Do you all think that's absolutely fine in Scotland, that we should have a postcode lottery because local decision making is more important?
Postcode lottery. If there's electoral accountability, then there's not a postcode lottery. It's if it's something that should be and is controlled centrally and you have no say over it, then it's a postcode lottery. But I think if councils choose to deliver services differently and you can vote for your council and you can vote for your councillors and make your views known at the ballot box, then that's not a lottery. In the same way that there's not a postcode lottery across the UK on higher educational funding, simply because there's been a different administrations have taken a different view. So I would say that is not what I would define as a postcode lottery, just to be difficult.
If I said variation in services instead. Does anyone else have?
I think you're getting right back to the question that Layfield posed. Do you want local administration or do you want local government? Go back to Wheatley and see what the principles are of local government. They're set out for us. We've summarised it for you. That's a choice that we have to make as a society. It's not a choice you can make as a parliament. You may think you can, but if you make the wrong choice, you'll suffer. And that's the point Alison's making. That's what democratic accountability is about. And that's why we as the Mercat Group have reached the view that the only way of taking this forward is not to leave it as a party political thing to be beat about. That will come, no doubt, when any legislation comes. That's what happened to Wheatley. Read the story of Wheatley. Wheatley set a good set of principles and set out a set of recommendations that got into Parliament and it got mangled. By the way, that was the word in the paper originally, but my colleagues made me change it. I'm using it now. It got mangled. Why did it get mangled? Electoral considerations. Okay, that's the reality of life. But if we can at least get a conversation going, get a set of principles started, and then I think the big choice then is for the Scottish Parliament, and I use that word carefully, not the Scottish Government, the Scottish Parliament, to set out what it thinks is appropriate level of government. And we'll go back to Willie's point, checks and balances. If you've got the checks and balances there, then you can allow discretion. So I don't think it's a simple choice between saying local delivery and local administration. There's going to be some balance in between those two. But this, with the current one, is definitely wrong and not working.
Yeah, just to pick up Bill's point about Wheatley, what Wheatley said is that local government should bring the people into the process of reaching decisions as much as possible to enable these decisions to be intelligible to the people. And I think all of the discussions we've had today, sort of we've talked about local government, central government relationships and so on, but is there a need for a more direct form of democracy where people are really engaged? And is this an opportunity, if we're talking about doing something to look at the whole of governance of Scotland, is this where something like a citizens' assembly would be an important way forward? Because with due respect to the Scottish Parliament, the usual process is to bring in the great and the good, and which would include the Scottish Parliament, and allow things to process through there. And is it not time that we did try to take advantage of some of the new mechanisms that have been introduced effectively in other countries like Ireland in order to tackle what is a very big issue?
Thanks for that. Thanks, Camilla.
Okay, thanks very much, Miles. And I do believe there is work going on about citizens' assemblies with various organisations. Electoral Reform Society, I think, are doing that kind of work. Colette.
Thanks, Convener. So, obviously, the committee have heard about the importance of localism, and briefly touched upon that as well, and police setting regarding budgets, and a discussion on, obviously, the range of services which could be provided by councils. I'm just wondering if you could set out your views on these issues, and obviously, having been a councillor before, I had worked on participatory budgeting and also 20-minute neighbourhoods, so I'd be keen to hear your views on those issues. Thanks. And I'll bring in Keith. Thanks.
Sorry, could I just establish what's the main point of the question is?
But I suppose it's down to localism from a local government point of view.
Well, I've always thought in local government that localism is, if you can define localism, is absolutely crucial, and it is about recognising about going down to the most local level appropriate. And certainly within the councils I've worked, I've always understood that when you do engage at the most appropriate level, you begin to get debate, you begin to get collaboration, you begin to get opposing views maybe coming together. And it's one of these things that very often is missing when you try to do things at too high a level. You're not getting that sort of rich undercurrent of knowledge and the networking that takes place. You know, at the local level now, it is fantastic to see that, you know, the engineer, I mean, I'm thinking about a wind farm that was put up in one of the communities in the Stirling area. And it's because there were a couple of engineers who worked elsewhere in the United Kingdom on it. And when the company came in and wanted to do it, they said, would it be possible to have an extra wind turbine for the benefit of the local community? And the answer was yes. And 5-6 years later, that £300,000 cost of the wind turbine had been paid off by the generation of electricity. And that particular village, that community, now has about £300,000 a year to go into local issues, because that network of knowledge at the local level allowed it to take place. So I think my take on it all is that there is a richness out there which would allow innovation. It's back to what Bill was saying about in the 19th century. It wasn't the government that decided that Glasgow's water supply had to be improved to stop the cholera. It was the Glasgow Police Committee in 1850 that took that decision. And the result of that was Glasgow got its water supply. That went to Sheffield, it went to Manchester, it went to Birmingham, and then it became a worldwide phenomenon. So innovation was about municipalities working alongside universities, working alongside the commercial interests in the area and bringing things forward. And then it's spreading, but it spreads not from the top down, it spreads from the local level upwards. And that is a quicker way, I think, of actually achieving many of the things that we do want to achieve, whether it be on climate change, whether it be on economic development, whether it be on tourism, than perhaps the way we're doing it at the moment, which is, you know, to my mind, far too much top down rather than the other way around. And if you've worked in a local authority, you'll realise that very often ideas that are generated there are worthwhile, and sometimes they don't work. And actually, it's better to make a mistake at the local level, where there's not so much damage, than making a mistake at the national level.
Okay, thank you, Keith. That's really helpful. I don't know whether Alison would like to come in on
that. There's been an awful lot of discussion about the relationship between the Scottish Government and local authorities, but of course localism is so much more below that. And I think there's a broader discussion about the structures, the numbers, the type of local authorities that we have in Scotland, and places like Highland are huge. That's a huge authority, and there has to be so much more devolution below that local tier of government and working with local communities, which opens up a whole other line of conversations and discussions about how best to do that, because the structures that we have around our local authorities are kind of another hangover from the 90s and don't necessarily best represent communities. Some local authorities do. Some, as I say, like the Highlands, are basically a regional tier of government. And it is important that there is power devolved and there are structures and all the checks and balances and all the other things that we discussed to ensure that those local communities are properly listened to and represented, and that those different issues that places face are properly addressed within those areas. And that does require that sort of additional level of a localism. Too often, I think, in Scotland, there's a discussion around about 32 is too many. But if you were to look across to many European countries, there are far, far smaller local authorities that can properly address local needs.
I know, I hear it often with my constituents in terms of it should be back to East Kilbride Development Corporation rather than South Lanarkshire Council. I hear that just about every week. So anyway, but thank you very much. Thanks, convener.
And just briefly, Bill, you indicated you wanted to come in.
It was just to say the important point about that is because we have gone for a structure which is basically we've got the Parliament and then we've got 32 councils, we are unlike virtually any other European or, for that matter, any other developed country. And I guess it's back to the Wheatley principles. That's one of the reasons we as a Merkit group are saying let's not argue about local government structures or anything. Let's get the principles right. The people that you're dealing with at East Kilbride are probably saying, well, there are certain things at East Kilbride that we want to decide, but they're not going to want to fire the strategic missiles or anything, or set national taxation. There are different levels, and a lot depends on what functions they can get. And there is a responsibility, I think, in this conversation to be realistic with people. Because one of the things that, one of the tensions that I feel we're teasing around here at the moment is the fact that it's very easy to say there's lots of efficiencies to be had in government or local government or wherever. But the reality of the world is a very complex and dynamic place, and it's very, very, very interrelated. And to do that, you actually need some people at the thinking level. And as Keith outlined earlier, a large element of that, particularly at the time of reorganisation in 96, was stripped out. A lot of the thinking power went. So one of the realities, one of the harsh realities, is democracy costs. And we need to spell that out.
Yep. Thank you. I think that's a very good point. And that kind of comes back to what you were saying before, like the knock-on effect when something is legislated for, where's the money in the kind of financial memorandum to actually carry those things out? We've got our final question, and I'm going to bring Mark in for that.
Thanks, Gina. There's been a real frustration coming from written submissions and frustration coming over loud and clear about the lack of action over the last 25 years, citing well-researched and produced report after report after report. If I could just start left to right and ask how positive are you when it comes to a meaningful change in relationship between local and central government as we go forward?
I'm left, am I? No.
Yeah, you're my left.
He was always in the left.
I'm an optimist. And when I started my career, I had a couple of years with the Scottish Office, and I always found relationships with Scottish Office and then Scottish Government civil servants was very good. And I think that conversation needs to be developed. But I just feel that in recent years, maybe it was austerity that prompted it. Maybe it was the desire of the Scottish Parliament to take as many powers as possible because it wanted to show that it could do things. But I just think that the consequence of that has really been that the relationship with local government hasn't been as good as it should be. And with all the different bodies that have emerged, they're quite powerful. They've got the ear of ministers. You've got one minister to represent local government, which is, you know, let's say a third of all public services, and you've got half a dozen or eight ministers who are representing the other quangos and such like. And it seems to me that the balance isn't quite right there, and there needs to be the recognition that actually local government is your friend, and local government could help deliver for the Scottish Parliament things maybe a lot more efficiently, a lot more effectively, and with a lot more innovation and engagement with local people than the way things are happening at the moment, where things are it's too much cascading down and not enough trying to suck up the ideas and the energy and the innovation that exists at the local level. Because my guess is that the ambitions, not my guess, my knowledge is that the intention of both the Scottish Parliament and local government and communities is very much the same, but there's almost this tension between them. And, you know, when we talk about parity of esteem, let's make that parity of esteem real, not just something that goes down in what Alison's been describing all morning as, you know, another report that sort of sits on a shelf for 10, 11 years. Parity of esteem should be the trust and relationships between the different levels of governance that we have at the moment. And those different levels of governance, I think, as Bill has said all the way through, needs to be re-examined to see if we can get that efficiency and collaboration that is, I think, sometimes missing at the moment.
Thank you. Bill?
I'm slightly less optimistic than Keith, but he's used to that. I would say that the starting point in addressing these issues rests with you as politicians. I think it's time you rose to the challenges that you set yourselves when this Parliament was first created. I detect, and this is a personal point of view, but I detect that over the last 30 years or so, and it's a worldwide feature, it's not peculiar to the Scottish Parliament, that politics has become more adversarial. In part, that's to do with all the pressures that you guys face. I genuinely take my hats off to anybody that stands for elected office these days, especially since the advent of social media. How you stand it, I'm not very sure, so well done to you all. But nonetheless, you as a parliament set yourselves a challenge, and you said you would find a more consensual way of dealing with things. You said you would delegate down to lower levels. And until we can get rid of the adversarial aspect of it, excuse me saying this, but if you really want to take forward a proper consensual review, then some of you are going to have to stand back and say, yes, we are going to have to let roses grow in the garden. We're going to have to accept that things will go wrong. We're going to have to accept that some of us got things wrong. I think that would be a good starting point. But unless we can get a cross-party approach to this at the Parliament, then even the suggestions we're making for a conversation to try and achieve some kind of consensus aren't going to happen. So my hope, and one of the reasons and thank you for inviting us, one of the reasons we pushed in our submission was that we see this pre-budget scrutiny of yours as a chance to roll this forward. To say, yes, you know what, it is time that we actually had a much broader look at things and we stood back. And the target for that, as we put in the final paragraph of our introduction, is next year when you're facing elections. So can I finish with a light-hearted note, right? You've all seen the film Gladiator, yes. In that film, there's a scene where the gladiator goes to his taskmaster and says to him, "You won the gladius, the wooden sword. How did you do that?" And he says to him, "Win the crowd. Win the crowd." To me, that sums up politics at the moment. And I'm not going to ask anybody here. This is general. And if you want to see it in spades, look at the American, what's going on in America at the moment. Win the crowd. If you win the crowd, you win the election. Do you want to do that? Or are you willing to stand back and say to people, hey, you know what? Democracy costs. As I said before, I'm glad I'm not going to be around to sort this out. Thank you.
I'm optimistic in the sense that I think there's a better understanding of what the issues are. I'm pessimistic about whether there's a possibility, whether substantial change will come. I think that my major area of interest is about the taxation side. I think the Parliament has got itself into serious Parliaments and government have gotten themselves into serious problems about the structure of taxation in Scotland. And I think that though that tends to be understood by people in the Parliament who are knowledgeable about it, the actual practicalities of electoral politics make it very difficult to do anything.
I think, apologies for the pessimism that's definitely there in our submission and perhaps that we've spoken, but I actually think that the crises that are coming in terms of our demography, the cost of living, austerity, all the sort of the budget cuts that local authorities are facing, there are problems across the public sector, and local authorities are key in terms of helping fix those. If you look at the sort of the health, education, justice, the early intervention programmes all have to be worked with at a local level. So I think there's a degree of optimism because if we don't, things will fall apart. We know the crisis that the NHS is facing. We know the problems elsewhere. I think that perhaps in previous years, things haven't looked quite so bleak across the piece, and that actually now there is an onus. If we don't do it, it's as every Audit Scotland report keeps saying, it is unsustainable. Something has to change. I'd agree with everything that you said about the need for cross-party working. And in terms of winning the crowd, there also needs to be honesty with the public. I think for too long there has been an element that there's an easy answer, that somebody else's taxes can go up, or that we can have everything and we can pay for everything. I mean, that's simply not the case. That the challenges that are being faced are difficult. Difficult choices need to be made across the public sector. And I think if there is some cross-party working in terms of saying and working with the public, this is the crisis that we're facing, there is no easy answer, we need to do this together, rather than the normal combative looking at each individual spending decision, such as free school meals for P7s, in isolation. If we carry on looking at every single spending decision in isolation, then I am more pessimistic. But if we can have more of a strategic cross-party approach, saying there is a solution, we can work together, we can be better, we can deliver what we've said before, then I think you can take the crowd with you, you can take the public with you.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much for that. We have gone over time, but I feel that it's going to be kind of frustrating if we're having this conversation next year. And I just wanted to point out, I mean, where does the local governance review that was in train and seems to have maybe gotten lost in some weeds somewhere in the Democracy Matters process, what's happened to those? Because I think those weren't they about trying to take the crowd with local government, with you know, third sector local government and national government? That was that process. So was it a useful process? Do we need to kind of find the fire in that again, or is it time to do something else, which feels like we keep doing different papers, as we've heard today?
I think what is required is political leadership. I think we've had all the papers. There's everybody else around Civic Scotland are crying out in almost agreement. If you look at the evidence that you've received, there is huge civic agreement about what needs to be done. I think it's being able to look to the longer term and political leadership and say, yes, we know we've got an election. Yes, we want to play to our own voters, but we will stand together and we will deliver. We have done it before in Scotland in terms of things like the Constitutional Convention and others, where parties have come together and worked together and delivered. The Smith Commission, there have been many examples where you can have political leadership, but we haven't seen that in local government reform, and I don't think there has been anybody kind of showing that. There's plenty of reports, but there's not that kind of political will.
Okay, that's very helpful. Thank you very much. And that concludes our questions. Many, many thanks for coming and joining us this morning and for your very useful contributions. And yeah, let's hope that 12 months from now we can maybe be talking about something a bit different or a lot different. That would be great. So as we previously agreed to take the next three items in private, that was the last public item on our agenda for today, I now close the public part of the meeting.